Hi, my name is Ken Hughes. Welcome back to the channel. This is clearly an episode about Taylor Swift. Look, she's all over my set. Taylor Swift is my guilty pleasure. But more about Taylor in a moment. It's about collaboration, the modern consumer value that collaboration is. And this is actually part two of a two-part series. Part one, the link is here. So if you want to check out that link and remind yourself about the shift from passive to active consumerism, do that. But collaboration is really about dissolving the line between the us and them. And humans actually are paranoid about this us and them line. We have this false separation from nature. For instance, we think it's all about us. We're at the top of the food chain, and so there's an us and the them. Every single war that's ever been fought, when you think about it, is it us and them problem? There's us, there's them, and then there's the conflict. And we do the same with our customers, actually. Every brand and every business has this idea that, you know, we produce and the consumer is somehow at the end of the value line, and they'll consume, and there's a division between us and them. And that's what I want to address today, dissolving that line and using collaboration to drive deeper customer lifetime value. Now, I want to show you a very, very simple way of looking at the world. This is a graphic that I designed, you know, about 4 or 5 years ago, and it certainly is even more true now after the pandemic. We've got three worlds as a consumer. You've got your my world, which is your soul, your center, your values, the very essence of who you are. It's very difficult for a brand to push into that space, but not impossible. So some brands like Red Bull, if you see a skater or a snowboarder wearing that Red Bull beanie, you know, they're not wearing it just to keep their head warm. They're wearing it because they have an affinity with the Red Bull brand around the X Games, around their self-identity. Harley Davidson do the same. Every Harley Davidson rider maybe has a tattoo of the brand logo on their skin. They believe in the brand. Apple, another really great example. You know, people queue for hours in the dark outside an Apple store to get the latest Apple device. They, you know, these are brands that have managed to push their way into the My World center. It's an amazing space for a brand to occupy because you've got tribal brand following, you've got empowered consumers. So that's the dream, getting in there. Now the next circle out is the our world, and our world is a world of community. So in the physical world, it's your school, it's your college, it's your office, it's your gym, the places you go, the people you meet. In your digital world, it's your Instagram, it's your LinkedIn. So these are your communities, and obviously that's a place where brands do want to occupy as well. They want brand community, they want to belong in your world, and again, it's a place of shared value. Again, hard to push your way into. The last circle out there is the pink circle, is everything else. Everything else out there is just the noise. It's the irrelevant brands, it's the transactional nature as opposed to relationship. And so that's not a space where you want to be, but actually most brands and businesses live in that space, that pink space. And so the question is, how do we push our way in? How do we push our way as brands into the My World, Our World centers, where we have some kind of shared purpose and shared values with the consumer? Sometimes it takes time. Sometimes it takes significant investment in customer experience, which is actually why CX has become critical to any brand and business at the moment. But also sometimes it takes creative genius. I want to show you a really simple example of a brand. God, this example is nearly 8 to 10 years old now. It was the Dollar Shave Club, a subscription blades business that shipped your razor blades right to your door instead of you having to go to the shop and buy them. And so the viral, which I'm about to show you, which was launched on YouTube, was the one piece that really pushed the brand from the outer pink circle into the our world center. And there's several reasons for this, but let's have a look at it and I'll tell you about it afterwards. Here you go.
Hi, I'm Mike, founder of DollarShaveClub.com. What is DollarShaveClub.com? Well, for $1 a month, we send high-quality razors right to your door. Yeah, $1. Are the blades any good? No. Our blades are f***ing great. Each razor has stainless steel blades, an aloe vera lubricating strip, and a pivot head. It's so gentle, a toddler could use it. And do you like spending $20 a month on brand-name razors? 19 go to Roger Federer. I'm good at tennis.
And do you think your razor needs a vibrating handle, a flashlight, a back scratcher, and 10 blades? Your handsome-ass grandfather had one blade and polio.
Looking good, pop-up!
Stop paying for shave tech you don't need. And stop forgetting to buy your blades every month. Alejandro and I are going to ship them right to you. We're not just selling razors, we're also making new jobs. Alejandro, what were you doing last month?
Not working.
What are you doing now?
Working.
I'm no Vanderbilt, but this train makes hay. So stop forgetting to buy your blades every month and start deciding where you're gonna stack all those dollar bills I'm saving you. We are DollarShaveClub.com, and the party is on. I know karate, I know jiu-jitsu, I drive like a gangster when I'm coming to see you.
So when you look at that, you know, Mike and his loose tie, his sneakers, he's one of us, isn't he? This is the us and them dissolve. So he's kind of pitching the business as, you know, you join me, us together, we'll fight the big guys, we'll fight the Gillettes and P&Gs of this world. You know, why should we be paying all that money for those razors? And so there is immediately, oh, I want to be with Mike. It's kind of a street food vibe, isn't it? It's like, I want to be with you. It's genuine, it's real, it's authentic. And he managed to do that with humor, with dress, with the style of the video. And that one video launched that business and really succeeded and pushed its way from that outer kind of irrelevant brand into, oh, this is us, this is part of my brand community. And so it is possible. And this brings us back to my guilty pleasure, Taylor Swift. So Taylor Swift is, of course, an amazing musician, an artist, but also a very, very smart businesswoman. And for years, she has understood the cultural zeitgeist around social media, around connection, around dissolving this us and them. So her Swifties, her fans, really believe that, you know, she is there for them and they're there for her. And there's this kind of interaction. She's always spoken to her fans a lot on social media. She's always given them access to her life via social media, and she's done a really good job in dissolving this line. And I want to show you what she did recently in terms of product and how you can use this as inspiration for what you do, whether you're in B2B or B2C or whatever industry you are in. Collaboration is critical with the customer, with the end customer, not with your competitors, not with other players in the industry, even though that is important too. What we're really looking for is collaboration with the end customer, and in her case, with the fan. So her latest single, Anti-Hero, was launched just before Christmas, at the end of 2022. Again, a spectacular hit. It's a song around anxiety and around how we sometimes look at the negative things around ourselves and blow those out of proportion. So I'm going to show you a little burst of the Anti-Hero video. Have a look at this.
I wake up screaming from dreaming. One day I'll watch as you're leaving, 'cause you got tired of my scheming.
Okay, so there is the marvelous Taylor Swift. Now, in the passive consumer model, in a non-collaborative model, she would just launch that product, the video, to the world, and the fans would consume it. And that's where it would end. But she is much smarter than that, and she wants to leverage collaboration. So instead, because the world is very much based around short little snippets of video today, TikTok, we have Instagram and YouTube trying to play catch up with TikTok, and they're launching their reels. And so on YouTube, you've got YouTube shorts, little shorts. And so she takes the chorus of her song, and she launches it on YouTube Shorts as a piece of music that you can layer over your own video. And she challenges her fans and the world to make their own little anti-hero videos. And she shows them how to do it first. So she launches this one around self-isolation.
It's me, I am the problem, it's me. It's me, I am the problem, it's me.
And then she launches a little more kind of playful one around the fact that she thinks her cats are people.
It's me, I am the problem, it's me. It's me, I am the problem, it's me, hi.
And so having pushed both of these out into the world, the kind of world understands, ah, I get it. She wants us to use the anti-hero and shoot our own little anti-hero video around what we think our personality traits are that are a bit weird, and the problem is me. And so that, of course, causes a tsunami of content coming onto social media about fans owning the product now and mirroring it back, and it becomes a collaborative space. So here I'm going to show you a few. Here's a girl who had a dream that her boyfriend cheated on her and was mad at him when she woke up.
It's me.
And here's another one about a girl who spends all her money on books, and that's the problem.
It's me, I am the problem, it's me. It's me, I am the problem, it's me.
And this one, my personal favorite, a girl who spends $40 when she's drunk on Taco Bell takeaway and ends up eating it all for breakfast.
I am the problem, it's me. It's me.
And you remember that first girl that had that dream about her boyfriend cheating on her? Of course, the wonderful thing about Taylor Swift is she understands the loop. And so she comments on that post. Now you've got a loop. You've got a me collaborating and posting the video. Then you've got the artist who's commenting on the video that you've just made.
I'm the problem, it's me. I'm the problem, it's me.
And there are tears there. There are tears of connection. And that's the point, isn't it? The emotive connection between the consumer and the brand. Once you create an emotional connection, that is when the foundations of customer lifetime value and tribal belonging are born. And so to move our brands forward, we have to engage in collaboration. We have to engage in a way of inviting our customers in, into the brand, into the production process, into the actual use of the product, beyond just transactional. And that's the space. That's the space where collaboration can really, really help. So we all need to become a little bit more Taylor Swift. And on that note, here you go. It's me. Hi, I'm the problem.